let me just say this. Thank you for allowing me to be your pastor, because if you were not here, I would have no one to pastor. Amen. Y'all love me like I love you? Amen. Amen. I'm grateful. We are celebrating 26 years. 26 years. 26 years. DeVille said I was 10. Amen. I have the opportunity to, you know, just travel the country. A lot of times I do a lot of pastoral celebrations. I go and I teach churches how to be good to their pastors and teach pastors how to be good to their congregations. Amen. So today I kind of just went through some stuff and I wanted to kind of read a little bit. Pastoring is not, it ain't a, I wouldn't recommend this position for a lot of people, because it can really take you somewhere. And I'm gonna tell you, I think that my greatest disappointment in pastoring, because I've had some great times pastoring, when I see people growing and I actually see the manifestation of the word going forth and people come and say, "Pastor, I'm growing," you know, that's worth it. But the disappointing part is when people leave, you know, because you become attached to a person, because we're supposed to be a family. And a lot of people don't understand, and they leave for different reasons, you know. And one thing, I am so sick of this term, church hurt. Because all of it ain't church hurt. Some of it is rebellion. Because we have to be able to teach our people. And then when we come down or we correct people, they get upset and they get mad, and then they'll say whatever they got to say about how the people in the church treated them, you know. But the Bible says that the Lord chastens those whom he loveth. Amen. And anytime I come to somebody and I'm correcting them, it's straight out of love. Because you know what my job is as a pastor? Is my job is to help and encourage you to get to heaven. My job is to encourage you to take a closer walk with God. That's what I'm here for. I'm your cheerleader. I'm here to encourage you. And my job is to not fool you. Because a lot of times, you know, pastors don't tell people the truth. Hello? And it doesn't make sense for me to act like, you know, and this is something that in the, you know, this is a church of truth and the word goes forth. I would be wrong as a pastor. I'm called according to Ezekiel 33. I'm the watchman on the wall and I'm supposed to warn you according to the word of God. I'm supposed to warn you when the enemy is coming to destroy you. And when I don't warn you, and tell you, look, stay away from that corner. Stay away from that person. The Bible says that if something happens to you, the blood of whatever happens to you is on my hands. So my accountability is very, very much. I have a strong, strong responsibility. I'm not here to get rich off of you. Hello. But I'm here to encourage you. Lady Wells was singing the song, and I hope you guys got it. Let every other God fade away. And I really want you all to get what that song basically says. That song is basically saying anything that you put in front of God has to fade, and then God can take his place. Do you understand the song? So she was working it. But let me tell you what that means. It means if your kids or your loved ones are a distraction from your worship, you got to kick them to the curb. Let every other god fade away. Anything that is a distraction from your worship that will distract you or deter you from worshiping from God, it's got to fade. It has to die. People. And it's normally people, y'all. It's normally people. What is your distraction? You know, the Bible says, who was it that made you fall away? It's always a who. Somebody say it's a who. So let me deal with this, couple of these things concerning a pastor. And y'all can just say amen. Let me read this and then we're going to do something else. This is what it says about a pastor. It says a pastor must be devoted to his wife, one woman. The pastor's marriage illustrates Christ's love for his church, his bride. The pastor must love his wife exclusively with his mind, will, and emotions, not just his body. Do y'all think I love this woman? Give me a check mark. Yeah, Lawrence told me while you were singing, you got a wife that look like she 30. Well, what I look like, Negro? I don't look 35. So, number two, a pastor's children must be submitted or in submission, though they are not perfect. If any man does not know how to manage his own family, he will not know how to take care of God's church. The first flock for a, and this is not just pastors, this is ministers, those of us that are in ministry, okay? You can't minister if you can't minister to your own house, not just the pastor. Hello. Don't be just looking at me. That go for all y'all that wear collars. Elder Vance, all of us, okay? And if I can't run my house, and I must say that I am the king of my house, and all my children work in ministry, give me a check. A pastor must be a faithful steward. And everything that I'm teaching you guys comes from Titus chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. Okay? Here's the terms used to overseer. It is not another office, but a functional title of an elder. It is what he does. He is a steward, a manager of God's resource and Jesus' flock. He takes responsibility, but not ownership. So this church is debt free because your pastor is a good steward. We have the only debt we have is our property, okay? And when we wanted to put that gate up a couple of months ago, $8,000, we paid cash for it. I don't like debt. I don't even like debt for myself. I don't play that. I mean, I can't teach y'all nothing if I don't do it myself. Amen? All right. A pastor must be humble, not arrogant. Now, let me say this. Although I'm light-skinned, okay, people automatically think I'm cocky. But my members can call me anytime they want. They all have my phone number. They text me. I'm touchable. And what you see is what you get. Members. Give me a check mark. Come on. Do y'all tell people that your pastor is good? You know, we was at the L.A. County Fair last week. And Andre Russell and another guy got up and gave me a shout out, and they said, that's the coolest bishop right there in all of the IE. That's because I speak to everybody. You know, I have a good reputation. I like people. A pastor must be gentle, not quick-tempered. I am a very calm person. I don't fly off the handle. Are y'all gonna say yes? When I'm explaining this stuff and y'all know it's me, y'all supposed to say yeah, yeah. Goodness gracious. Because you know they say, you want to really see what a pastor is like, they say look at his wife when he's preaching. You know, when you, especially when you see a guest pastor. If we ever have a guest pastor and his wife come, just look at his wife reacting to his word. If she look mad, he done made her mad. You know? So, check. Come on here. Thank you. A pastor must be sober, not a drunk. I don't drink. I don't even get high. I don't pop pills. I don't even cuss. A pastor must be peaceable, not violent. A pastor must be prone to inflict, a pastor is prone to inflict violence through his word. Okay, good. Through his word. I am violent through my word. Because I ask y'all sometime, am I hollering? Because I'm passionate about the word of God. But not violent with people. The pastor must be hospitable, okay? A pastor must be a lover of good. I like good and holy things. A pastor must be self-controlled. A pastor must be upright. I believe in living according to the word of God. My integrity is good. A pastor must be holy, okay? His life must be devoted wholeheartedly to Jesus, external and internal, internally, excuse me. A pastor must be able to teach. I think I can teach the word of God just a little bit, okay? And I love the word. Are we a balanced church? Y'all think we're a balanced church? Okay, we love to give God praise. We tell people the first 45 minutes of our church, if you come, we driving hard. But after we get through driving, pastor got a word he gonna teach. All right? The pastor must be spiritually mature. Pastor must be respectable. And the pastor must be an example for his flock. Check. Okay, thank you. All right, now let's go to this other thing. Ways that the congregation can help their pastor. First thing you can do is pray for him. Pray with him and pray for him. Pastors need prayer every day. Not only are they bombarded with mental administrative tasks that steal their time, they're exalted with temptations to pride, laziness, and lust. Among other things, we ought to pray for their perseverance in remaining qualified, which includes being above reproach. So basically what they're saying is pray for your pastor that I don't yield to temptations. Okay, because y'all see pastors be falling. And can I help y'all with something? Don't get it twisted. Jesus, the Messiah, that fool Lucifer and Satan, look at Matthew 4, had the audacity to come and tempt him when he was vulnerable and weak in his flesh. So if he will come and tempt Jesus, the Messiah, y'all don't think he'll come and tempt me? That's why y'all can't trick me, because I know if I get tempted, y'all be getting tempted too. Don't come up here and act all holy all the time. I know y'all be slipping. I told one of my members not too long ago, I said, I know what's up with you. I said, I know you be doing things when you don't call me. Yeah, when you want to walk with God, you call me. But when you don't call me, I know you up to something. Look at somebody and tell them, we all get tempted. We don't all fall, okay? But we all sometimes slip. But look, before you slip, just grab onto something and hold. And when you hold on to something, it got to be the word of God. Slipping just means that I almost did it. Oh, look at somebody and tell them, I almost did it, but I came to church. See, you being here right now is you holding on to something, because the devil could have took you somewhere else today or last night. But you stayed home so that you can get rested up for church. We all slip, but we don't all fall. The Bible tells us, yield not to temptation, for yielding is all kinds of stuff come to our heads. Don't beat yourself up. You know what? And this is something, I'm going to help y'all with something. Your mind has its own mind. Have y'all ever thought about something and you say, why am I thinking about this? How did that get in my head? Because your mind has its own mind. In other words, I think Paul said that your mind has its own heart. So all you got to do is shoo the stuff that come out of your mind. Just shoo it away. Hey, devil, the blood, get away. The blood of Jesus, the blood, 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 blood. Start singing something. Mary had a little lamb or something, just to get it out your head. Mary had a little lamb. Jesus was his name. Jesus was his name. Get away from me. Affirming your pastor is always good, okay? Every cook, I tell my wife all the time, affirming means to make them feel good. Just, you know, I tell my wife all the time that her food, when she cooks, I would tell her, girl, that was a good meal. You know, because first of all, I want them to keep coming. You know, so I just tell her, I said, ooh, that was good. That was like Sunday's Tuesday. That was like Sunday morning. That was a Sunday meal. Don't I tell you that? That was good, girl. Y'all can tell. I mean, look at my stomach, you know. Thank you for good. So I'm affirming her as a cook. I affirm her even when I tell her, you look beautiful. I don't need no man telling my wife she look beautiful. I tell her. She came in the room Saturday before we went to San Diego looking like Taraji Henson. I had to look. I said, hey, beautiful. I like that hair. She evidently didn't hear me. She said, you like this? I said, yeah, you didn't hear me when I said I like your hair. You heard me. You just wanted me to affirm you again. Everybody wants to be affirmed. You know, my sister here that just came today, like, girl, that blonde look good on you. See, and me telling her that look good, she gonna keep that blonde in her hair. She's gonna say, ooh, well, Bishop said that look good on me. I was going to turn it burgundy, but I think I'm going to keep that blonde. Francis, your blonde look good on you, too. Y'all gone. Your blonde look good on to you. Next week, it'll be blue, I know. Talking to him or affirming him about his messages. And talk the word. Members, talk the word to each other, you know, talk the word and encourage each other. As I said before, and this is actually on here, it says, tell them how God is growing you. So that affirms the pastor too, okay? Here's one, care for him financially, okay? Pastors typically make little money. Your pastors may even qualify for food stamps. This ain't my thought. I'm reading this, okay? Though he never tell you, true, he ought not shepherd the flock of God for sordid gain. According to 1 Peter 5:1-4, but if your pastor isn't being paid generously, his mind and his heart are likely divided. And let me just help you with that, with that anyway. I do minister better when I have money. just like you do the same thing. You sleep better. Look at somebody and tell them, I sleep good when I got money in the bank. Don't nobody sleep good when they broke. That's all this is saying. You sleep good when you got money in the bank. You don't have to worry. Because the Bible says that money answereth all things. That's good. You need money. We all need money. Okay? And I always say this. How many of you all work a secular job? Okay? Let me ask you a question. Do you want to be successful in your job? Do you want promotion on your job? Do you want to make money on your job? Absolutely. And this is my full-time job. And everything that you said yes to, I say yes to also. For real. Ain't no sense in lying. Okay? And the thing is, y'all, I just gotta, you know, let me say this. I gotta say this. For a small church. No, this is a gratitude. For a small church, y'all take good care of y'all pastor. Because and I think it's probably going to say, I don't want to get ahead of myself. This is a tedious job, making sure I have to. Every week is like a physical examination for me. Not a physical examination, school examination. Every week I have to make sure that I'm in that word. I'm toiling over the word to make sure that I have a good sermon for y'all. Every week I'm just like, oh, God, this guy, I just need a word. So it becomes a lot. You know, and I'm always doing, you all are always in my thoughts. Always in my thoughts, individually. I have a pastoral list of all of you guys, and I just go through the list and pray. And you guys are always on my thoughts. Always. Y'all get texts, well, we're kind of changing the system a little bit. But y'all get the text from the 909-733-2700. You know, for years, those texts come from me. Every text. I'm keeping up with you guys. I'm letting you all know what's going on here at this church. Amen? And I'm so grateful that you all blessed me. But can I help y'all with something else? Okay? The key, and I'll show you in the scriptures, but the key to your financial blessings is through me. It's the word. You sow into your pastor, and God blesses you. Not making me rich, okay, but sowing into your pastor. And this is something that we miss in the African-American church, because we have the thought that the pastor is getting rich off of you. And I always say this, y'all, how can I get rich off of you when you're not rich? You're not giving that much money for me to be rich. And our financial people will tell you that I'm one of the highest tithers and givers in the church. I have an outside hustle. This ain't my only thing. I'm in the music industry, okay? I'm a promoter. I'm a radio personality. So I have other incomes, okay? So when people say stuff, why your pastor is, why he there, tell him he got other jobs. He ain't just pastoring. Hello, pastor has investments. Amen. I just took thousands of dollars and dropped it into an investment so that it can turn. And I'm waiting for it to turn so I can come back and show y'all how to do it. Amen. So as I elevate, you elevate. Is this okay, me talking to y'all like this? Because every now and then we need to have these. I want to see y'all successful. And I just love it when I look out in the car, I look out there, and I see all these nice cars. We're gone, y'all. God is blessing you. He blessing you. You are supposed to be blessed. When God created you, he created you to dominate and rule the earth. So all we doing is walking in what God called us to walk in. And the thing that took that from us was sin. So if you know you're righteous, and I always tell y'all, rewards come with righteousness. Okay, it says, let the elders who rule well. Do I rule well? Okay, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor. So I deserve double, according to what the word of God says, amen? Especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. This is what I teach when I go to other churches, okay? You shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, for the laborer deserves its wages. And basically what he's saying, that anyone that works hard on anything, y'all work hard for y'all's job, right? So you get paid from your job, right? So an ox, he says, don't put a muzzle, don't put a block. The animal should be able to eat of its labor. Amen? And that's what we do for everybody that labors here. We try to give them something. Not only just me, but everybody. We like to sow. We ought to make sure our pastors are financially stable, the local body combined with their financial resources. They give to their pastors to free him to shepherd without concerns for his poverty. Okay? Watch out for his kids and his wife. Allow them. Oh, this is what it actually says. It says, watch his kids and give him and his wife a date night. My kids are grown. Y'all ain't got to worry about that. Let me say this. I want to thank Mother Corinne for the last probably 3 years. Every Wednesday, faithful, she brings dinner. Thank you. Every Wednesday, faithfully. Okay, care for his wife, love his wife. Thank you. We actually did an interview recently, and we were talking about how the church, you know, loves our wife, loves my wife. And I tell people all the time, you know, I'm so appreciative that y'all love the first lady. You know, but let me say this too, she's lovable. You know, and I was telling somebody the other day, I said, the blessed part, you can have a good pastor who builds, and if his wife is crazy, it can tear down everything that he builds. Come on, y'all. And Lawrence, right? Lawrence thinks that his first lady is the best. When we go to other services, he always judging other people's first ladies. And I mean, I'd be like, shut up. You know, he loves his first lady. He thinks she's the prettiest thing around, and can't nobody sing better than her, and she this and that, 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 that. Well, that's good. And that's his first lady, and that's the way he should feel. But he better not say that to anybody else about their first lady. Shut up. Don't make no enemies. You know? And it's okay for y'all to feel that your pastor and your wife is the best thing west of the Mississippi. It's okay. It's all right. Okay. Build his library. That means if you see a good book and you think it's a book that the pastor should have, give it to him. Follow. Here's the best thing. Follow his leadership. Let me read what this guy says. He says, I purposely saved this one for last. Submitting to your pastor may be difficult, but you'll bring joy to his heart and to yours if you fall under his godly leadership. If you believe in his leadership, don't be a problem. Hello? My father-in-law is 85 years old, and he's going to live to be 100 because he's already proclaimed that. He decrees it and declares it. He said that, and every time we come together as a family, he always thinks, and he'll start crying in the middle, you know, but he said, I just thank y'all. I'm going to live to be 100 because y'all don't give me no problems, you know. And it's the same way with pastoring. I always think about that. If I know that everybody is living a good life and a blessed life, that means less stress for me. Amen. Listen to your pastor. And I do have a pastor spirit, and I have a father's spirit. I bet the writer was telling Paul, he said, we have many pastors, but we have few fathers. And that's the spirit. Pastor Bolton is old enough to be my daddy back there. Okay. But it cracks me up when him and Mother Corinne call me daddy. You know, Corinne said, you my daddy. I'm like, girl, watch that. Only one daddy. That's the daddy. But they always call me dad, you know, and it's out of respect, you know, that they recognize the Father spirit in me leading them. Amen. And I appreciate Lawrence too. Y'all know Lawrence can be a pain in everybody's side. Not just their sides, but their behinds. Check, check, check. Double check. But as much as he is, he runs his mouth too much. He don't know when to stop. He just goes on and on and on. But at the same time, if the pastor, if I need something, even when I know he don't want to do it, you know, and I know that when he hangs up the phone, he got something to say to himself. I know he has something to say, but he'll respond, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. You know? And I don't know where Davida is, but Davida, you know, where's Davida? Have her stick her head in here. Teacher! That's what the kids call her. Teacher. Teacher. Let me say, and you know, this is Pastor's Appreciation this afternoon. I'm not going to be able to say a lot of stuff, and y'all not going to be able to say a lot of stuff because we're coming in basically to have service. But I don't know where Davida is. But you know where she is? She's somewhere working. Okay? She is always working, and I just so appreciate her and how she always, yeah, I'm trying to, can she stick her head in here? For a second. Okay, I got about 10 more minutes. Okay, yeah, just stand right there. Yeah, y'all give her. So, no, I just wanted to take this time and tell you thank you for serving. You know, I really, really appreciate how you serve me. And she's another one that just says yes, sir, and yes, sir. And, you know, and even a couple times, she's hung up in my face a couple times, y'all. You know, but you ain't never hung up in my face. She's hung up in my face about 3 times. And I'm like, I told my wife, I said, okay, she got one more time to hang up in my face. You know, but you've been with me for how long? 20? Yeah, since she was 16 years old. And she's 50-something now. Okay, when we started in my garage, she was there. So what she does, though, she hangs up before she says something she ain't supposed to say. And that's what you got to do. Let me hang up before I lose character. You know, but I appreciate you. I appreciate you how you serve Lady Wells. I mean, she is there for this woman. Now, that part I'm jealous for. I'm jealous for that because even yesterday she drove by herself to San Diego to make sure that she got dressed. She was with us. She had to change outfits, and she was there making sure that all her stuff was there. She got there, made sure the room was there. She don't get paid for that. She used her $6 a gallon. You know, and I offered to give her gas. I said, you need some gas? She said, no, I already gassed up. You know, anywhere she goes. So I'm trying to get me a Davida. All right, thank you. I appreciate y'all. I appreciate every one of y'all. I'm not going to talk about everybody because all of you all do a lot of things, you know, but these are people who really, really, really serve over and beyond. And I just want, and I acknowledge you. My elder, my ministerial staff, this man right here stepping up has taken up so much pressure, you know, from me. He does all the assignments for everything. You know, I haven't taught a Wednesday night Bible study in years because Elder James makes sure that Wednesdays I don't have to worry about that. I can focus on other things, you know, and you all know that y'all share me with the nation, right? You know, I'm over a national organization, so a lot of that takes a lot of my time. And knowing that my Wednesday night Bible studies are taken care of and Sunday school is taken care of and anything with biblical education, he got it. Okay? And let me just put this disclaimer out. Elder James is really funny and nice. He just looked mean. He's smiling under that mask, but he'd be sitting there like this the whole time. And you say, "Laugh, Elder James," and he's actually going, "I am." But you get him by himself, he is just a nut. I mean, he laughs and all that kind of stuff. And his persona is like that because he's a teacher. And, you know, with these kids, you got to practice letting people know I'm not playing with you. That's why some of y'all's kids is wild, because these teachers are cowards, okay? And our kids going in there disrupting the class. Hello. Yeah, anyway. Okay, good. Okay, he says this: obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping, here's a Hebrews 13 and 17, this is what it says. Obey your leaders and submit to them. This is why. For they are keeping watch over your souls. I have an accountability to make sure that you guys are getting fed, okay? As those who will have to give an account. That's what the scripture says. I have to give an account. Let them that do this with joy and with not groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you.
We hope you've been blessed and encouraged by what you've seen and heard during this Spirit of Love Christian Church presentation. Our church is located 2898 Northeast Street, San Bernardino. If you would like to share in giving, you may do so at Zelle, at Spirit of Love Christian Church, PayPal, at Spirit of Love SB, at gmail.com, Cash App, Money Tag, SOL Church.